Welcome to As the Story Grows. I'm Brian Patton. Today, Entheos frontwoman Chaney Crabb joins the podcast. Entheos's new record, Time Will Take Us All, is out this Friday on Metal Blade Records. Chaney talks about the metal scene in Iowa, the formation of Entheos, the themes on Time Will Take Us All, and more. Before we jump into the interview, let's talk about Time Will Take Us All. The first thing you will notice about the record is the artwork. Elleron Cantor did the artwork. He's done records for Testament, Halloween, Soulfly, and more. This is just a visually arresting image that really captures the album title. Chaney and I talk about it in our interview. You have the staircase leading into nothingness, into the great beyond. It's such a visually interesting piece of artwork. I think that's an underrated aspect of music these days, especially as everything has gone streaming. But the artwork is so cool on this record. It's something I've asked a lot about in recent interviews because I just think the artwork is an underappreciated side of music. And those people who are old like me who used to go into the record store and just flip through LPs and just pick up interesting record covers and buy records based off the cover, this is a record that I would buy just looking off the cover. Entheos comes out the gate with Absolute Zero and In Purgatory and even The Interior Wilderness and just hits you over the head with crushing metal song after metal song. Chaney's vocals are unrivaled. She's in that Will Ramos range of just like incredible vocal diversity from her deeps to her demon growls. And she even explores clean singing on this record. And it just really shines. Her vocals are just top notch on this record. Once you get to Oblivion, the band really settles down and they let Evan Brewer shine. I got to see Evan Brewer back 12 or 13 years ago at the Black Cat in DC performing solo, and he blew me away. I had no clue who he was at the time. I was not listening to The Faceless yet, and I just absolutely fell in love with Evan's style of play. And anytime I get to hear him on albums, I love it. And Oblivion is really the track where Evan shines the most, although his fingerprints are all over this record. Entheos does a great job of creating space. This album is heavy, and it is a great death metal record, but it is also very open and atmospheric. Oblivion, Into I Am the Void, the title track that closes the record, Time Will Take Us All, you have these moments where the band just lets the sparse soundscape surround you, and Chaney's clean vocals are great on this record. She talks in the interview about her time in choir, and that singing voice has not left her. And it's so great to hear just this beautiful singing contrasted with just like the demon screams that she's mastered. It's great. There's really two bands that I think capture what Entheos is going for. And I think it is the mathiness in Animals as Leaders and Naveen spent time in Animals as Leaders as their drummer. So that carries over into Entheos. And really on this record, there's a lot of great starts and stops and just like the technicality in his guitar work and drumming contrasted with Evan's just phenomenal bass playing. And the other band or era this reminds me of is kind of that Alaska era Between the Buried and Me, which you also hear Chaney and me talk about our love for that record. And I think this is just a good combination of that progressive metal that's not prog rock, but really just like more on the technical mathy side, combined with just like great hardcore and metalcore. And I think Entheos has really gone above and beyond on this record. I think it's going to be on a bunch of album of the year list. It's super great, and I highly recommend checking it out. If you like death metal, you'll like this record. If you like technical death metal, progressive death metal, Animals as Leaders, post-metal, ambient metal, check this record out. You will love it. All right, enjoy this week's chat with Chaney Crabb from Entheos. How's it going?
It's going good. How are you?
Doing good. It's like I saw the time that it was sent to me as 10:30 Pacific, and I was like, okay, great. But that's still how I put it on my calendar. And I was like, here this morning, And then I was like, oh no.
I do that constantly. I did that yesterday with an interview. It's so hard because I just moved from Pacific time to Central time. So I'm programmed to go by Pacific, and I get it confused all the time.
Yeah. It's tough. I am grateful that I usually have somebody else work out the time zone differences and just relate to me, because I'm just I don't know, London is who the fuck knows.
Right.
What led you to move away from the West Coast?
Honestly, just buying a house.
Yeah.
Buying a house on the West Coast. What the house that we ended up buying, it's like this would be $1 million on the West Coast, maybe even more. And so that was really the driving factor. And when it came to being able to buying a house, it was like, let's get out of here.
Yeah.
I want to own some property,
Yeah. Yeah. I'm on the East Coast, and yeah, the money paid for the house I own, for the size of the house, you're just like, that's criminal.
Yeah, I know, totally.
It's ridiculous. Where did you end up moving to?
We live in Nashville, a suburb of Nashville, which, it's kind of crazy. There's a bigger, we lived in Santa Cruz before, and there are a lot of metal bands from Santa Cruz, but it's just a really closed off community because it's surrounded by mountains. Yeah. So there's a bigger metal scene here. It's been pretty cool to hang out with our friends who are in Nashville and become a part of a different scene.
That's cool. That's cool. How long have you been there?
A year.
A year?
Yeah. We moved in December of 2021.
Nice.
Yeah.
Has that fundamentally changed how you route touring and figuring out where you're heading out since you're not on one coast?
Oh, hell yeah. I mean, honestly, it's given us more opportunity with smaller runs.
Yeah.
The national tours, it's kind of fun because we have a member in Sacramento and we have a member in Las Vegas. So we can go and start in different places in the country, and we always have to fly people out no matter what. But we did a really small 1 week long run with Oceano last year that we definitely would not have done if we still lived on the West Coast. So it makes things like that way more accessible.
Yeah. That's rad. Well, let's jump back in time. Where did you grow up?
I'm from Des Moines, Iowa.
All right, Iowa.
Yeah, I love it.
What was growing up like?
It was cool. I mean, I have a great family, and I played music. I started playing music when I was in eighth grade, so 12.
Yeah,
that's when I started really getting into metal and going to shows and playing music and stuff. So it's that's pretty much been my entire life. And Des Moines at that time was kind of a really good place to to be into local bands because it was right after Slipknot had blown up. And I mean, Slipknot are local heroes to us. You know, a bunch of the guys who were on that first Mate Feed Kill Repeat EP that they put out, like, went on to be in other phenomenal Des Moines bands. So it was a really good time to be a part of the scene. And the like, a ton of people would go to the shows. And yeah, kind of, I was raised on that stuff.
That's cool. Yeah, you don't think of Iowa as like a hotbed for metal or heavy music.
Yeah, no, you don't. But that's like what Slipknot came out of. There were a bunch of bands that were around and doing, like, playing shows with Slipknot. They just happened to be the one who put us on the map, kind of. But they inspired a lot of people. That's for sure.
Yeah, yeah. It's cool to talk to different people who grew up in different places to see, like, how local seeds like build up. And it's like isolated pockets of just like, yeah, hardcore metal lives here. Like,
totally. I mean, my fiance, who is in the band, who's in Entheos with me, he grew up in the Bay Area of San Francisco. So there's a ton of stuff that I don't know about their local scene and that I ask him about all the time because it's super interesting to find out. Like, their scene was popping off. You know, Gilman, that venue was popping off as far as hardcore and punk and kind of metal went. So it's cool to hear stories from him.
Yeah, yeah. What got you into music initially?
I don't really know. I've just always been into music my entire life. My uncle is a bassist, and I lived with him like the first year of my life. And honestly, I think that my grandma was always like buying me instruments and stuff. So I don't have any idea what got me into it. I just have always, it's always been a thing in my life.
Yeah, yeah. Maybe Slipknot in general, but like, what got you into that heavy music scene?
It actually wasn't Slipknot that got me into it. It was just going and seeing local shows and hanging out with kids at school who were into metal. And they would like make me, you know, I made friends with a group of metalheads and we would make each other like compilations of different stuff and just being around people who wanted to play music. That's like, that is the friend group that I started having when I was in probably eighth grade.
Yeah.
And we would just like watch disaster pieces and watch all kinds of metal DVDs and shit and get together and nerd out about that.
Nice.
Yeah. Nice.
At what point did you decide you wanted to play in a band? Was it as soon as you discovered it?
Pretty much right away. I mean, I was like in musicals in school. I sang before, and so I was in swing choir and doing stuff like that. And I was a performer. Oh, now you can hear the drums.
Oh, yeah.
But I was a performer always. So when I got into metal, I think it was just kind of naturally for me to be like, well, now I know exactly what I want to do. I know how I can take this to the next level. So.
Yeah. Yeah. Were you drawn to like the front person role?
Definitely. I mean, I played drums too, and my drumming didn't develop as quickly as it could have just because I didn't have a drum set, you know, that it was expensive. So I think so I wanted to be a drummer hypothetically, but really the front person position is where I always went when a band happened.
Yeah. Yeah. What were your influences as you like developed into a front woman, like as a screamer?
My early influences were like, there was this band called Index Case that's from Des Moines, and the vocalist Joe was a huge influence for me when I first was starting out. Randy Blythe is honestly like, Randy Blythe was the person who introduced me to the idea of like all of the screaming being catchy.
Yeah.
And not having to wait for like one catchy screaming moment in a song. There are a bunch of bands, but yeah, it was primarily that, like, the dude Mark from Chimera, I was way into. Karen Crisis is a woman whose vocals I was way into back in the day from the band Crisis. She, I feel like she doesn't get enough credit for how fucking amazing her voice is and how great her range is, because she goes in and out from like screaming to yelling to like weird chanting and singing, and you know, she's got a great range. So early on it was, I mean, those are the ones that come to me right away, but there are a lot, really.
Yeah. What was the process like transitioning from somebody who was in choir to like learning to scream and growl and that transition?
I don't know. At first it was just, I guess it wasn't hard, or it just felt kind of normal, honestly.
Talk to me about this project, Entheos. How did it get started?
Yeah, so Entheos got started because basically Naveen was doing a solo project and he was on tour in Europe. And he kind of like was wanting to start a band, because doing a solo project is fun, but you don't get to like high five after a set and say and talk about how sick you were that night, how great your set was, you know. So he wanted to start a band. Our bass player at the time, Evan Brewer, had just quit the band The Faceless, and Frank, who was our original guitar player, was trying to record a rock album with Naveen, because they all are go way back. They were all in a band called Animosity together. And I'd known Evan for a long time as well, because I like did a tour with him. But so we all kind of knew each other, and basically Naveen orchestrated the entire thing, and that's how the band started. And we just kind of, we wrote some songs together. We never really thought that we would play shows. That wasn't, there was no like intention behind the band, except that we wanted to jam. So that's how it started.
That's cool. Because like Naveen had spent time doing Animals as Leaders, and Evan, like Evan is fucking Evan. Like, did that really influence like that technical progressive side of the sound?
I mean, I think that there is, there's like from Animosity to Entheos, there is much more of a melodic voice in Entheos than there was in Animosity. Like the riffs and everything are definitely still kind of there, or they're still definitely there, but still kind of similar.
Yeah.
But I honestly think that Entheos sounds more like Naveen's solo project Flesh Rot. And and yes, what you asked, I do think that him playing in Animals and Evan doing his solo project played a great role in what our band sounds like, because Animals made Naveen a bit more of a polyrhythmic player, you know, a choppy. He already did have those chops and stuff, but I think that it just brought a new element to his playing. So yeah, we're totally in the natural progression of those two doing that and then coming back into a pretty like heavy metal band.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's like an interesting, like I was talking to someone the other day and it was like death metal is having this moment, like this resurgence in popularity. Mm-hmm. And it's like your band in particular, especially this new record, which is phenomenal. It's like this really, it's like this cross between a band like Animals in that it's like very technical and like BT BAM and like,
totally.
But it's still like super heavy and like, it's a good balance and cross section.
Well, thank you. That's like, That's a huge goal for us. Like, we really, even more so now, we love adding like melodic passages and you know, sections of dynamic and clean vocals singing, yeah. And all of that stuff. But we are always going to be a heavy band. Like, that's where Naveen and I come from. We love playing heavy music, and that's never going to leave our sound. Yeah. I think that a lot of bands, when they start to become more prog, or they start to incorporate singing and things like that, they almost push all the way in that direction, right, after. And that's something that I just don't see us doing, because we love death metal a lot, you right. know?
Yeah.
And we're like death metal freaks, so we're always going to have that element in our sound.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like, I love Between the Buried and Me, and like, yeah, all their prog stuff is super cool, but like, I always listen to Alaska.
Dude, Alaska is I will die on that hill. Yeah, that's my favorite BT band record.
Same. Yeah.
Because it's the perfect blend. It's what you're saying.
Yeah, yeah, the keys are phenomenal on that record too. It's
So good. I love every aspect of that record. That was like, I remember back in the day when everyone had that intro riff to Alaska as their ringtone. Man, yep.
Yep. Where'd the name come from?
The band name?
Yeah.
So the band name was like, when me and Naveen and Frank were starting the band, we were reading through books looking for a name. Nothing really stood out. And then Frank was like, what about Entheos? And he explained to us that it was the Greek root word for enthusiasm, and that it means the God within. And we were like, that's the fucking name. So that's how it came about. It didn't take much.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's awesome. How'd you guys end up? You guys have had different labels for each release. Like, what's that transition been like, Artery to Spine Farm to Metal Blade?
Well, the ultimate move to Metal Blade has been the greatest transition ever. I mean no harm against Artery or Spine Farm, but I just don't really think that they were the labels that our band was meant to be on. I don't think that they really knew what to do with a band like ours, but Metal Blade to me is the quintessential. Like, if I look at Naveen and I did a thing when we were deciding who to sign to, when we sat down and looked at each record label out there, and we looked at the bands, and we were like, what releases do we feel like our music relates the most to? And Metal Blade had all of the bands.
Yeah.
So, and on top of that, it's like Naveen has, he put out his solo album Flesh Rot on Metal Blade. For me, Metal Blade's the dream label. So it kind of just all came together that, you know, and we have a good relationship with the people at the label as well, which is really important.
Yeah. Yeah. Because he had put his solo record out with Metal Blade, was it easy to like find that relationship and that in there?
Yes. And because we knew Ryan Williams, who was, he used to be the bass player of the Black Dahlia Murder, but now he's the A&R guy at Metal Blade. And, you know, just that was easy because we've known Ryan, you know, so it's easy to forge relationships that when you already kind of know people at the label.
Yeah.
talk to me about COVID and lockdowns outside from just being this like awful thing that happened to everybody. Like, how did it affect the band and where you were headed?
I actually am one of the people who loved the lockdowns because I could just be at home and I had no FOMO about it. For the band, I think it really, that's at the end of the day, what really solidified us writing a record by ourselves, me and Naveen, as two people. And it kind of like pushed us further in that direction. It gave us a really good chance to write the record and just, you know, focus in on it and not really have much else going on. So it was a good time. It came at the perfect time for our band.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's cool. Your record titles, The Infinite Nothing, Dark Future, and Now Time Will Take Us All. There seems to be some underlining theme in all the titles. Do you see it that way, or is it just like happenstance?
I think that the underlying theme in the titles is that I come up with all of them, and they all definitely reflect like my sense of the world, I think. They're all sort of melancholy, but also hopeful in their own ways. So yeah, thematically, they like I haven't written them to fit together, but that's just kind of how they end up for sure. It's all from the mind of Chaney, I guess.
Well, time will take us all. What are the lyrical inspirations in this press release? It talks about your scooter accident and
So the scooter accident kind of like kickstarted the record, and it became like this. I want to call it conceptual. It doesn't like tell a story from beginning to end, but it all is about growth underneath the realization, or just the fact that we're all going to die. And it's kind of like Absolute Zero, the first track on the album. I wrote that directly after I got in my scooter accident. Mm. It comes from a serious state of being down, mental anguish, I would say. And progressively, the album just gets, you know, there's a little more relief as each song passes by, and it ends with the final song, Time Will Take Us All, which is the ultimate relief, I guess. So yeah, it's just about growth and life and dealing with like the bigger questions in life.
Yeah. Yeah. When you guys sat down to write this, were there things you knew you wanted to accomplish musically that were different than what you've done in the past?
I think we knew that I was going to sing on the record probably, but we didn't necessarily sit down and say, all right, this is what we're going to do. We knew that we wanted to make the album heavy. That was a must, because we kind of feel like we missed the mark on making Dark Future super heavy, which is fine. It is what it is. But so we wanted to do that. We knew that we wanted the art and the lyrical content and everything to fit together and tell a story together and, you know, kind of feel symbiotic with each other. So things like that we knew, but overall it was kind of stream of consciousness as far as writing went.
Yeah, you mentioned the artwork. The album art is like super cool. The like eyeballs as clocks are like wild. Like, who came up with the concept for the art?
I came up with the concept for the art, but Eleron Cantor is the artist. So as much as I can take credit for like the idea behind it, it wouldn't have looked how it looks without Eleron working on it. And he did a magnificent job. He has done a lot of metal covers. He's done stuff for like Testament and Halloween and fucking Thy Art Is Murder, Despised Icon, all kinds of bands. So his work is pretty well known. And yeah, he was the only person that I wanted to do art for the record. Yeah. I was really like, when it came to this album, those are things that I really knew. Like, I knew exactly who I wanted to do the art. I knew exactly who I wanted to make our music videos. So like on the artistic side, it's like, We really had that all nailed down, where I feel like we didn't 100% do that in the past.
Gotcha. Gotcha. What was your thought or concept behind the artwork?
It was really to use the title and to put the title on the cover. The eyes, you know, they're kind of like, the eyes seem a little anxious to me. Like they're anxious about time running out, which is the clock on the eyeball. There are two heads on the cover, and each of the heads is a castle or a kingdom that's crumbling, with a staircase moving up the middle. So it all really represents like the anxiety that can be associated with life and death, and but also, you know, the growth within that.
Record is out March 3rd, so just over a month away. What's 2023 look like for the band?
Looks like we're doing a lot of touring so far. We're going to Europe in February, and then we have another, we're getting back from that, or not February, in March, and then we're getting back from that, and we leave 10 days later for a US tour. So it's going to be pretty busy. I would like to personally put out some more music before the end of the year, so we'll see how that goes.
Yeah The drums in the background, are you guys like working with somebody else right now, or?
Oh no, that, so we have a studio in our house, and our friend Mike Lowe, who is in the band In Fury, I don't know if you've heard of them, but he is tracking for his band Oubliette. So that's our friend Spencer playing drums in there. They're tracking an album right now.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Is that part of why you bought the house? So you could have the studio as a place for you guys creatively, but to invite friends in to record?
Definitely. I mean, we definitely had that in mind. We call it like Entheos HQ because, you know, we've got a lot of room here, and we do a lot of shit. We do a podcast and have the tracking room and a control room. And so, yeah, it was definitely a part of the idea. We didn't really know if people would come and track here, but they have been. And the studio looks fucking cool. So it's rad to have.
That's awesome. That's awesome. What's your podcast on? Just the band, or?
The podcast is called Copper Crab Podcast, and Naveen and I do it together. We talk about the band a lot. We have some of our friends on it. We also just kind of talk about what it's like to be musicians in a touring metal band and everything that, like, the realities of what comes along with that lifestyle. So
yeah. It seems like these days people are more like aware that like it's not all like rock stardom and like awesome, that it kind of fucking sucks.
Yeah, dude. Or, you know, that we're not all like drinking a bunch of beer and snorting cocaine off of strippers and stuff. It's not like that.
It's not fact, Metallica in the 80s.
Yeah, it's 100% not like that. In fact, we like go to the gym and don't really drink, you know. Right. It's way nerdier than it used to be. That's for sure.
Thanks for listening to As the Story Grows. Our intro music was written and composed by Jeremy Hunt. The As the Story Grows theme is by Bob Nana. If you like what you hear, subscribe wherever you get your podcasts and give us a rating and review. If you'd like to support the show financially, you can join us at patreon.com/asthestorygrows. Be a part of our community and join the ongoing conversation over on Discord. If you enjoy this episode, share it on social media with your friends. Much appreciated, and thanks for listening. I never felt so young.